the Church of God or the Full Gospel Fellowship of America or the Assemblies of God. Amen. We're here, we're put on this earth to build the kingdom of God. And I think it's high time and past time that our community here in Lafayette, amen, that we have more fellowship between our churches, and not just our two churches, amen, but I believe that this is just a start.
Yes,
amen. I believe,
that's right.
Pastor, what God wants to do in Lafayette, I believe that we're going to see more, amen, more pastors, more churches coming together, praying together, worshiping together. I believe that's God's plan for our community. Amen. If we're going to have revival in our community, amen, then we need to have it across the board. Amen.
Amen.
Not just to lift up one. Amen. I'm afraid of just lifting up one. The only one that we want to lift up is Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
So I just thank God for that. Amen. If you've got your Bibles this morning, I want you to turn with you to the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter number 14. 1 Chronicles 14. I love to talk about David. I love reading about David. Everybody, most people anyway, they can identify with David. Because we've seen David as we read David's life. We've seen David was when he was up spiritually, he was strong spiritually. And we also see David when he was down spiritually. And we see also how God raised him back up. How many's ever been there where you've been close to God? Amen. You've had breakthrough in your life. You've had victory in your life. And then somehow, we don't know how it happens, but somehow we find ourselves drifting. Yeah, we wake up one day and say, my God, how did I get where I'm at?
That's right. Yes.
And it's not ourself. It's not just us that we wake ourselves up, but it's God waking us up, causing us to realize that we're not where we need to be.
That's right.
Amen.
And that's the way that God pulls us back in.
Yes.
That's the way that God ministers, amen, to those that have strayed or those that are wayward. But I want to tell you today, the good news is that God has you in His hand.
Amen.
Amen. You're not here today, you're not saved today because you're so good. I'm not here today or saved because I'm so good. But I'm here today because God is not willing to let go.
That's right.
Hallelujah. We have a God that loves His people.
Yes.
Turn around, touch somebody and say, hey neighbor, God loves you.
God loves you.
Come on.
God loves you.
Amen. Hallelujah. I want to talk to you today a little bit more about David. Just to start with, before we start reading in 1 Chronicles 14, let's go back just a little way. We know how David was anointed to be king as a young man. How that he came up in the ranks, how he slew Goliath, how that he became King Saul's son-in-law, how that he became the man that led in the armies of Israel out to war and back in and after victory. And there were songs sang about him and praises gave. And, you know, Saul had lost the anointing. David had gained the anointing, but Saul was still king. Saul was jealous of David. He tried to kill David. Amen. David got on the run because of fear, went down to the city of Gath, to King Achish, amen, in a place that he didn't belong, down in the land of the Philistines. Amen. He was backslidden for a year and 4 months.
Come on.
I said he was backslidden for a year and 4 months.
Amen.
Amen. You tell me that God is not the God of a second chance.
Come on.
Yes, that's
or
right.
Or a third, or a fourth, or a fifth.
Yes.
I don't care where you're at today. Listen, I want to tell you that God is trying to speak, amen, to each one of us, telling us no matter where we've been, no matter how we've let the enemy trample us,
that's right,
no matter how we've allowed the enemy, amen, to pull us away, God is pulling us back.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. I say, God is pulling us back. God has a plan for your life. God has a plan for your family. And God has a plan for this church.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
David went out he went so far out away from God that he was willing to fight against his own people. Went out to fight against them. He was turned away. Go back. Ziklag was burned with fire. He lost everything spiritually and physically and financially bankrupt. Amen. And finally, after a year and 4 months, David prayed. Amen. Do you know that no matter how long you've been away from God, God is still waiting on you just to pray?
Amen.
That's the key to everything is pray.
Yes.
It's really that simple. Just pray. God will not turn us away if we pray.
Come on.
Listen, if we pray, if we're covered by the blood of Jesus, you know how we get our prayers answered? Number one, we need to be a child of God.
That's right.
Amen. You know, if we're washed in the blood, He'll hear our prayer.
That's right.
Amen. And you know what? God will direct us in our prayer. He'll guide us in our prayer. And He'll not only do that, but He'll answer our prayer.
Come on.
That's it. Hallelujah.
David praying for the first time in a year and 4 months. He encouraged himself in the Lord, the Bible said. You know what that means? He got right with God.
Amen.
He turned back to God and away from self.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
And so David said, my God, I don't have anything left. I'm bankrupt. I'm empty. How many's ever been empty spiritually?
Yes.
I'm empty. God, what am I going to do? God, can I go try? Can I at least try, Lord, to get back what you gave me to begin with?
Yes.
God said, listen, and I believe we could add just a little piece, and I don't think I'm going to hurt the scripture when I say this. God said, since you've turned to me, go ahead. Since you've came back to me, go ahead and pursue after the truth. And you know what?
Hallelujah.
David recovered all.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, Friday night I preached the message, and the title of the message was, what do you want to recover? What is there in your life that's been missing, amen, that you want to recover? What is there in our churches that we need to recover?
Come on.
Let me tell you, the foremost thing, the best thing, the premier thing is we need to recover the presence of God in our lives, in our homes, and in our churches.
Thank you, Jesus.
We need the real presence of God, not just a formality, amen, not just going through the motions, amen, not just having religion, but we need a real relationship with God again. So David recovered more than he ever had before. God will bless you with more than enough. David knew that he was anointed to be king. Even now David is walking again in the spirit. But you know, there came news that there was a battle and that Saul was dead. And Jonathan, his son, was dead. And David knew the promise of God, and the promise of God had been reestablished in his heart. You know, but the difference between David before and David now is before David ran away from God, amen, to the world looking for help. But this time, David learned from his mistakes. Do you know we're supposed to learn from our mistakes?
That's right. Yes.
I don't believe there's a man or a woman that's truly a man or a woman of God. If we've done something wrong in the past or handled something the wrong way, whether it's a relationship, whether it's a duty, whether it's a service for God, no matter what it is, if we've handled it wrong in the past, guess what? God will give us opportunity to make it right.
Oh, yeah.
Not Amen. Make the same mistake over and over and over again.
Amen.
So you know what David did? David waited upon the Lord this time. He knew that he was supposed to go back and be king. But he didn't just go. He didn't just assume that it was okay for him just to march back in and say, all right, I'm here, make me king. But what David did something different this time. David prayed. David prayed and said, Lord, what will you have me do? And God said, I want you to go to Hebron. I want you to go to Judah. And when David got there, you know what happened? They crowned him king of Judah. He reigned for 7.5 years. During that time, Ish-bosheth, Saul's son, a weakling son, was king over the northern tribes of Israel. Amen. And Ish-bosheth was a weak king, and the Philistines and the Amalekites and all the enemies of Israel, they just bombarded the northern tribes of Israel, and they were oppressing them. They were robbing them. But you know what was happening in southern Judah? While David was king, they enjoyed prosperity. They enjoyed, amen, protection. They enjoyed the presence of God under a king that was anointed. How many of you know that the anointing is very, very important?
Come on. Yes.
We can go through the motions, but if there's no anointing, it doesn't make a difference, because the Bible said it's the anointing that destroys a yoke of bondage. And if not my know-how, not my, maybe I've gained some skill in speaking or singing or leading or putting things together. We can have all the best programs in the world, just like in the Garden of Eden when God made man. Amen. He made the body. He put it together. He formed him out of the dust of the earth. But there was nothing until the breath of God, the anointing.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Was blown to that man became a living soul. Amen. We're just a mic. Listen, we're nothing. We're a dead thing without the breath of God as a church.
Hallelujah.
Amen. We need the breath of God, the anointing, back in our churches.
Hallelujah.
Back in our homes and back in our lives.
Come on, brother. Preach.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yes, yes, yes.
After 7.5 years, Abner went to the people, the northern part that Ish-bosheth was ruling over, and he said, you know what? He said, for a long time, he said, you people have whispered. He said, you've talked about making David king. He said, now then do it. Do it! He said, Ish-bosheth is dead. Do it. Make him king. There's something there I want to tell you real quickly. That the northern tribes could not enjoy protection and peace and prosperity until they made David king over all. You know what that's saying to us?
Come on.
The reason we have so many problems in our life is because we have yet to make Jesus king over all.
Come on.
Hearts.
Come on. Amen.
The Bible said, as long as Ishbosheth was alive, the Bible said there was a long war between the house of Saul and the house of David. Or there was a war, let me put it this way, there was a war between the flesh and the spirit.
That's it.
That's right.
Until David was made king over all.
Yes.
And there's going to be a war in our hearts and our minds and our lives until we make Jesus king over all. We can't have, amen, Jesus on Sunday in the nightclub on Monday. We can't have love on Sunday and hatred on Monday and bitterness and jealousy on Monday. I tell you that God wants to be king over all of our heart and every day of our life. But the first thing that David did after he was made king over all of Israel and Judah, the first thing that he did, he knew that God had a plan for Jerusalem. Jerusalem was a place that the city of Jebus, the Jebusites were there. Amen. It was a place that many times people, the children of Israel, had come and they tried to conquer Jerusalem, the stronghold, a place where they were always unsuccessful. But David said, you know what? He said, I'm going to conquer Jerusalem because that's going to be the city of God.
Come on.
Thank you, Jesus.
Think about this before we even get into this message. Think about this. Is there something in our life that since we have been a Christian, I didn't say before, I said since. Since we have been a Christian, is there something in our life that it seems like we just can't conquer? Is there anything in our life that we just can't get past or get over? Is there some reoccurring trouble that continues to plague us?
Come on.
Can I tell you something this morning that God wants to put victory in your life?
Come on. Yes.
I said, touch somebody. Touch. Look to your neighbor and say, hey, God wants to touch him and say, hey, God wants to put victory in your life.
God wants to put victory in yours and your lives. Yes.
So David now is on his way to conquer Jerusalem.
Rolling along.
And here's where we want to pick up. 1 Chronicles 14, starting in verse number 8. The Bible said, and when the Philistines heard that David was anointed king over all Israel, all of the Philistines, not just some of them, but all of the Philistines went up to seek David. And David heard of it and went out against them. And the Philistines came and spread themselves in the valley of Rephaim. Everybody say that with me, the valley of Rephaim.
The valley of Rephaim.
And David inquired of God. Here David is praying against him. David learned his lesson. He knew that because of a lack of prayer and a lack of a real relationship with God that he failed before. Amen. Now I want to tell you, David has learned his lesson at least up to this point. And David said, you know what? I'm going to make prayer, amen, a priority in my life.
Hallelujah.
Somebody's not hearing me. Listen,
yes.
God says to us today, we need to make prayer a priority,
yes,
in our lives every day.
Hallelujah.
Prayer. We can't do without it.
No,
try holding your breath and not breathing. You can't do it. Prayer is the breath, amen, that God has placed in our living soul, amen, that keeps us alive. It draws in the atmosphere of heaven, and amen, and it, we exhale and it goes out to the world.
Hallelujah.
Think about it.
Man.
Oh
my gosh.
Woo.
Good.
But David in verse 10 inquired of God, saying, shall I go up against the Philistines? And wilt thou deliver them into mine hand? And the Lord said unto him, go up, for I will deliver them into thine hand. So they came up to Bel-Perazim. Or let's say that again. Bel-Perazim. Bel-Perazim.
Bel-Perazim.
Let's say it that way. Everybody look at somebody and say, I need to be in Bel-Perazim.
I need to be at Bel-Perazim.
And David smote them there. David got what God said he could have, and that was victory. Everybody said, I need victory.
I need victory.
Victory Tabernacle Church of God. Man, when you stop and you think about some of the names of our churches. The name of our church over on Butcher Switch is World Harvest Lighthouse. We need to be harvesting, amen, and be a lighthouse to the whole world, not just to one people.
Amen.
Yeah. Victory Tabernacle Church. We're supposed to have victory.
Come on.
Yes.
Victory. Yeah. Not defeat. Victory.
Victory.
Then David said, verse 11, so they came up to Baal-perazim, and David smote them there. Then David said, God hath broken in upon mine enemies by mine hand like this, like the breaking forth of waters. Therefore they call the name of the place Baal-perazim. And when they had left their gods there, David gave a commandment, and they were burned with fire. And the Philistines, listen, now they gained victory. What did it say? It said, I want you to listen to what it's saying. Sometimes we just gloss over, amen, when we read, and we don't really let it sink in. What did God give them?
Victory.
Now,
what happened? The enemy was defeated, and guess what happened? Here they come back again. Now let's read it. Verse 13, and the Philistines yet again spread themselves abroad in the valley. Therefore David inquired again of God.
Again.
And God said unto him, go not up after them. Don't do it this time. He said, turn away from them and come up on them over against the mulberry trees. And it shall be when thou shalt hear the sound of the going of the tops of the mulberry trees, then thou shalt go out to battle. For God has gone forth before thee to smite the host of the Philistines. David therefore did as God commanded him, and they smote the host of the Philistines from Gibeon to Gezer. And the fame of David went out into all the lands, and the Lord brought the fear of him upon all nations. Bow your head with me one more time and let's pray. Father, God, we ask you in the name of Jesus today to minister, God, to us, your people. God, starting with my life, Lord, I need victory.
Amen.
God, for our people, Father, for this pastor, this church, and our churches together, Lord.
Amen.
Your body, God, we need victory.
Hallelujah.
Because it doesn't, Father, no matter what goes on in our life, it seems like the enemy continually comes back. God, to rob us of victory, Lord, and to, Lord, to push us down, to press us down, Lord, and to cause us, Lord, not to pray, to cause us not to worship, to cause us not to have that right relationship with you, not to fulfill your will for our life, your plan. God, today, would you restore unto us, God, the power of your presence, God, so that it's real every day of our life. In Jesus' name we ask it. Everybody said amen. I'd like
amen.
To preach to you, amen, this thought, victory at Baal-perazim. Verse number 8 said this. It said, when the Philistines heard that David was anointed king over all Israel, then they all came together and they said, you know what, boys, we've got some trouble now. Because why? Because now they're united. They're not divided. I want to stop right there and just speak to this church, both churches. We're all one body.
Right.
We can never, ever be what God wants us to be as long as there's any disunity in the church.
Amen.
I don't care how small it might seem.
Amen.
You might say, well, I have a certain pet doctrine that I'm going to hold on to, and no matter what the pastor, no matter what the leadership of this church or any other church, no matter what they say, I'm going to hold to this. Listen, that's disunity.
Yes.
I'm sorry. I'm not talking about a pastor being a guru. I'm not, and I know Pastor Mike doesn't want to do that. I know that, listen, no real pastor, no man of God wants to control every little part of a man or woman's life or
or
their home or their family, to where you've got to ask them what you can eat or where you can go on vacation.
Come on.
That is a cult. That's not a church.
That's right.
Come on.
Because everything that we do, God has taught us through his word, has to be of a free will.
Yes,
that's a free will offering, a free will sacrifice of self. Amen. If we're forced or pressed, it's just not going to have the same result.
That's
just plain and simple. But you see, when the enemy knew that they were united, amen, that's when the enemy attacked. And there are some people that are in churches today, they feel like if they can quote the right scripture, if they can say the right word, if they can pronounce things just a certain way, if they can have just the right program, that everything's going to be smooth. Well, you know what? They're in for a big disappointment.
Amen. That's right.
Because my Bible reads that any man that will live godly is going to suffer persecution. That means test or trial, temptation,
yes.
So forth.
Yes.
In any church that will come together in unity with one mind, amen, in the spirit, amen, heading the same way, amen, submitting ourselves to leadership that God has put over us, can I tell you this, amen, that the enemy's so afraid that we're going to get it together, amen, that we'll be such trouble for him. Whenever we do get it the right way, guess what's going to happen? You're going to be attacked.
Uh-huh. Hallelujah.
You're going to be attacked. And the devil's going to send every possible play, every possible dirty trick that he can possibly play. And I tell you, in the name of Jesus, we need to understand this real plain. The reason we don't see victory today is because we need to make Jesus king over all of our hearts.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Not just have my private life and have my church life.
Come on.
We're not afforded that luxury. I want to tell you today that the enemy is not afraid of a half-hearted Christian. The enemy is not afraid of a religious church. The enemy is not afraid, amen, when people stand and say, oh, bless you, I'm a Christian, we'll pray for you. But the enemy is afraid when we get to the place where we surrender and God fills us with the Holy Ghost, amen. Amen. Come on.
Yes.
We're born again, a child of the Holy Ghost, and then we're filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Then the enemy, amen, the fear of God strikes his heart.
Yes. Amen.
He says, oh, boys, we're in trouble. It's when we begin to pray in the name of Jesus over our families. It's when we begin to walk in the anointing of God, amen, that the devil begins to shake and shudder. Amen. He's afraid, amen, that we're going to recover what he's taken from us.
Amen.
He's afraid that maybe somehow we're going to get over the hump. Amen. You know, there have been Christians that have been in our churches for years. Amen. And they still deal with the same sin.
Come on.
They still struggle with the same battle. And I tell you, there's no big secret to it. It's not because one person has more willpower than another that anyone is able, amen, to live a more successful Christian life than somebody else. It's simply this, amen, that we begin to surrender to God.
Come on,
and make Christ king over all of our hearts. You know, it's almost like we rope off a little private part of our heart. We stake it off and we say, listen, God, you can go in every part of my life except this one part. I'm keeping that one for myself.
Oh,
can I tell you, listen, that is just, it's disaster waiting to happen.
Amen.
That's all that it is. I believe that God is raising up men and women from the pulpits of our country today in our denominations, amen, our Pentecostal ranks, amen, that are preaching it's time to give all of our hearts to God again. Men that will go back to the basics of Christianity, amen, and stop looking for sensationalism. Amen, I'm so tired of sensationalism. Amen, we've got to preach a greater message than what we did last Sunday or God can't move into it. I've got to have a different program more exciting than last week or God can't move it. Listen, I want you to know this. We need to be satisfied with whatever God is doing among us. Amen. Amen. Sometimes that means pruning.
That's right.
Sometimes God has to cut away some things in our life. And because we're not, amen, having a shout and a run while we're being cut on, amen, we feel like God isn't doing anything. I tell you, in America today, God is moving. He's pruning the church. Amen. He's cutting away some things that we've grown, amen, that does That's not right. belong.
That's right. Amen.
God is trying to prepare himself a bride.
Yeah.
Amen. God is preparing a church, amen, just before Jesus returns. Amen. That's full of power and glory and full of prayer.
Amen. Yes, sir.
Amen.
Somebody that desires real victory. Amen. Not just the name of it.
Come on. That's a good word.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
You know, if we look at the sick people and we say, well, I hope you start feeling better. If somebody's in the hospital, the church sends them a card and says, you know what, man, we just want to tell you that you're on our mind. Oh, sure, it makes people feel good. But you know what the devil's really afraid? He's not afraid of all that. But let me tell you what the devil's afraid of. Let me say that prayer cloth one more time. When we get full of God, amen, when we've learned our lesson, amen, because of lack of prayer in our life, and that's all the real secret there is to it. Amen. If we'll stay in the presence of God, we won't have to worry about the enemy defeating us. Amen. But when we get full of the Spirit and we get full of a desire to be in the presence of God, and we know that we have to depend on Him and everything that He can do and is done.
That's
amen.
Right.
And
amen.
I want you to know it's then that the anointing comes. Amen. The anointing is not going to, man, to stay with us, amen, when we're out in sin.
Come on!
I'm sorry.
Hallelujah.
How do I know? Because King Saul lost his anointing.
That's right.
But when we get full of the anointing, Brother Pastor, I want to tell you something. We begin to lay hands on people in the name of Jesus and pray over them and say, be healed and be delivered and set free. Come out of that addiction in Jesus' name. Amen. Come out, amen, of the world of shame in Jesus' name. Receive what God, and listen, we see lives beginning to change. When churches are bold enough again to stand up in public and anoint a prayer cloth, because now there's power in that cloth, but to send it out in the name of Jesus and say, you know what? The prayers of the saints of God and faith is going forward. And we anoint them. Listen, then the devil begins. begins to shake and shudder. When people begin to get full of faith again and full of obedience to the word of God, friend, I want you to know that's when the devil, amen, starts to, amen, says, fellas, we better do something about it.
That's
come on.
It.
Hallelujah.
I've told this story many times. I'll tell it just a brief story about Israel this morning. 1917, the League of Nations.
Yes.
They gave Great Britain a mandate to go and to take back Jerusalem. General Allenby, some of you heard his name. General Allenby went. He was a man of God. He prayed. He said, God, how can I do it? I don't want to destroy Israel again. He said, you know what? He said, there's got to be a way. So he went to his pastor. This was the General Allenby. Amen. He said, I don't want to destroy Jerusalem again. It's been destroyed, besieged so many times. He said, this is a city of God. He said, tell me what I can do. He said, let's get down and pray. And God showed him that night how to march in. And he conquered Jerusalem without firing a shot.
Hallelujah.
Listen, it was held in bondage by the Turks, amen, 400 years. By the Mohammedans, they were there for 400 years oppressing this land that God had a plan for. Amen. But because of the signs of the times, because of the age, the church age coming to a close, God was just about to restore Israel as a nation.
That's right.
From 1917 to 1947, they were there like a policeman. But they got blamed for every little thing that went wrong. And they said, we've had enough. We're getting out. Amen. Joseph Ben Gurion and a group of men got together. They drew up a Declaration of Independence. The day that Israel, amen, was free of Britain, they declared their independence.
Hallelujah.
I want to tell you something. Everything that has ever happened to Israel, God still wants to speak to the church.
Come on. Yeah. That's right. That's amen. Right.
How many of you would agree with me and say we're living near to the coming of Jesus?
Yes, we are. Today? It's here. It's here.
When Israel declared their independence, guess what happened? The very next day, millions of Muslims attacked Israel. What does that say to us? When we declare our independence from the devil, when we declare our dependence on God, you better know something. The enemy's not going to like it. He's going to make trouble in your life. I said, he's going to make trouble. I don't care what you've heard on television. I don't care what some slick-haired preacher has said. I'm telling you in the name of Jesus, this is what the Word of God declares, and we better be ready to handle it.
Yes, we have.
The reason we see so many people backslidden today and out of the will of God now, the church of God, is because they've been led down the garden path and promised a rose, and they didn't tell them about the thorns.
Right. Come on, brother.
But I want to tell you something today. Listen, there is blessings of God. There's more blessing in God than there is out of God. But I want to tell you something. You better be prepared to want it, to stand for it, and to go through the battle for it.
Amen.
And there's only one way that we can go through the battle and be successful, and that is to have communication with Him.
Amen.
That's right. Amen.
So David had victory. And after that victory, you know what? They spread themselves again. Again, they came back to try to defeat David again. He was on his way to victory. I want to tell you today that we need to get victory back in our sights.
Yes.
There has been, we have far too long, the church has lived under a false doctrine that we cannot have victory in our lives. I want to tell you, if you can trust the grace of God for salvation, my friend, you can also trust the grace of God for victory in your life.
That's right. Hallelujah.
I believe that God is trying to raise up, amen, His children again today to begin to declare the message that victory belongs to you. Victory belongs to us. Amen. We can have it. It's not, amen, something out there that set the force that we can't reach or have.
Amen.
It's time that we have faith in the Word of God again. Verse 8 said that all the Philistines went up to seek David. They all were chasing after him. Every one, they had all the weapons of war. They turned against David. You see, these were the people that you got to understand. These were the people that watched David. Some of them watched David when he was a young boy defeat their champion Goliath. The man that they thought could never be whipped. I want to say, when we are washed in the blood of Jesus and we get anointed, every demon in hell goes crazy. Church, I want to tell you something. We need to get good and saved. I believe, truly, if we had the right altar call and the right service, I believe that most of the church world would have to come down and give their hearts to Jesus Christ instead of just going through the motions of religion.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
I'm not trying to judge anybody because I didn't die on a cross. So I therefore can't judge anyone, but I can tell you what the Word of God says.
That's right. Preach it.
I can't tell you whether you're saved or not. Only you and God know that.
Come on.
That's right.
You can't tell me whether I'm saved or not because that's between me and God. But I believe this. I believe when a person truly gets born again, it happens first on the inside, but it will show on the outside.
It will show.
Come on.
Amen.
That's the truth.
These same demons that got nervous, amen, when they seen David and all of Israel coming in unity, amen, these are the demons that afterwards saw Jesus die on the cross. They seen Satan defeated at the cross of Calvary, amen. And I tell you, when we get anointed, amen, when we start to get on the territory that the devil has stolen away from the child of God, amen, we're going to do something for the glory of God. Satan's going to try to send everything he can against us. But I want to tell you today that victory belongs to the church. Victory belongs to the children of God. My God, today, if I can say anything, if I can reach in my pocket and give each and every one something, I can do it, I would. But I tell you that we've got to go to Jesus for it. And that is victory. Victory belongs
to
him.
Come on. Amen. Amen.
Verse number 9 said this. It said, and the Philistines came and spread themselves in the Valley of Rephaim. They took up position in the Valley of Rephaim. It was on the southwest side of Jerusalem. And what this meant, why this was such a strategic move, and why, amen, that the enemy, amen, played it so cunning and so smart, is because they cut off all communication between David and his help. The army that David had there, they cut the supply lines off. And I tell you, listen to me. When the devil can't defeat you one way, he'll try another.
Right.
Yes, they will.
He tried to ambush David, but you know David prayed. And you know what? Here he is now. He's cutting off. Amen. Why is so significant this Valley of Rephaim? Because it's between Bethlehem and Jerusalem. It's between the place of birth and the place of victory.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
I said between the place of birth and the place of victory, the devil wants to cut off our communication with God.
Amen.
He wants to stop up our prayer life so it's not effective. He wants to put so many things in our life that we're so weighed down. Amen. We're so burdened down. We're so distracted. Everybody say, God help me not to be distracted.
Come on,
help me. Help.
That my prayer life is of no use. It's of no effect. It's not even real. It's just basically going through the motions.
Lord help us.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord help us.
Rephaim was also a place of dead kings. This Valley of Rephaim. There were dead kings there, buried there. What is that saying to you and me? If the devil comes to us after spiritual birth, we're on our way, and we've got victory at the cross. You're not going to ever get any more saved than you are the very first day that you're saved.
Amen.
You might, listen, you might grow in grace, you might develop, you might get mature, but I want to tell you in the name of Jesus Christ that when Jesus washes all of our sins away, he washes all of our sins away.
Yes, he does.
When he causes us to become a new man or a new woman in God, I tell you, we are that, just that.
We are. Amen.
But this place, Rephaim, was a place of dead kings. You see, they were counting on the flesh, but David was in touch with God. What is that saying to us? Sometimes when we get in trouble, we find ourselves in a fix. We're tempted to run back to the things that used to rule our life. Somebody needs to hear me today. God is trying to deliver. Amen. God is trying to pour in victory today.
Thank you,
Lord. It's so easy to be tempted that when the rough times come, and they will, when temptation comes, and it will, when persecution comes, and it will, if you're trying to serve God.
Come on.
It's easy to be tempted to try to fix things ourselves, to try to put things back in our own, take them away from God and put them in our own hands, say, I know what to do, I'll fix this.
Yes.
I'll take care of this. I know how to escape. I've got a place of refuge that I used to run to. You see, anything that ruled our life, I'm talking about sin, anything that ruled our life before salvation was like a king over us. It ruled us. And so here the Philistines, and they're in the valley of Rephaim, the place of dead kings. They're running to the old things. But I want you to know, amen, that it's not enough to run to old things. David had learned his lesson, amen, when he went to Gath, when he went to King Achish, amen, and he became a servant of the Philistines, amen, because he had no prayer, he had no communication with God. He was undone. My God, church, we need to know today, if we find ourselves in trouble, the first thing that we should do, the very first thing that we should do is run to God in prayer. The things that are meant to drive us in the presence of God, amen, sometimes we let them drive us out of the presence of God.
Amen.
Don't run away from God, run to God.
Amen.
Good work.
Thank you.
And I know that there are many of us. Listen, there are many of us that have experienced victory in our life time and again. But then after that time and that experience of victory, it seems like the devil attacks and we fall back in the same old rut. One old country preacher said one time, he said, "Do you know what a rut is?" Because they always said, you know, you're falling in a rut. He says, "It's just a grave with both ends knocked out. You're a dead man."
Oh my.
Living a dead life. Yeah. Walking back in the same old valley of Rephaim, of a place of dead kings. Going back and letting something rule over us that has no business ruling over
us. That's right. Amen.
Verse number 11, look what it says. So they came up. They left Rephaim. They came up to Baal-perazim. And David smote them there. And David said, "God hath broken in upon mine enemies by mine hand like the breaking forth of waters. Therefore they call the name of the place Baal-perazim." This is an important part. Victory at Baal-perazim. What is it saying? What does that name mean? Put in real modern simple terms, it means this. It was a place where we got a breakthrough.
Amen.
How many of you need a breakthrough?
Yes, I need a breakthrough.
You've been trying to serve God. You've been pressing up against the wall of prayer. Amen. You've been trying to live the life. You've been trying to worship God. You've been trying to seek God. And it seems like you can only go so far. But my God, can I tell you today, this very day is a time of victory for you. It's a time of breakthrough in your heaven. I tell you, God sent me here to tell you this morning, church. Amen. You've been wanting breakthrough in your life. All you've got to do is trust God for it this day. Amen. Not tomorrow. Not the next day. This day, God said He'll send forth revival. What is revival? It's God showing up and giving His presence, amen, in the body of His people, amen, so that we can be revived. Amen. If you've ever had victory in your life, God wants to give it again. Church, listen, I tell you, in the name of Jesus, this church many times has been at the point of breakthrough, and the devil has pushed back. But Pastor, I tell you, in the name of Jesus, you're now not at the point of breakdown. You're at the point of breakthrough. Amen. God is just about to break through. God wants to give this church victory. Amen. God wants to give this church, amen, powerful vision. God wants to give this church fruit for its labor.
I believe.
Amen.
I believe.
This is the day of God's church coming together. This is the day, amen, where we can believe for victory and have it. Amen. It's one thing to give a false promise. Can I tell you something? The Bible tells me that my God is not a liar.
Come on.
Amen.
That's right. Whew.
It doesn't make a difference how the enemy attacks. If we will just go God's way, if we will understand God's plan, if we will understand God's method, amen. You know, you don't have to worry about getting on the wrong road if you stay close to God.
Amen.
There's not a big secret to it.
Amen.
God help us. Preachers of America have made it so complicated. Yes. They've got their own special potion that they want to give the church.
Come on, brother.
Well, if you'll come over to my flock, let me tell you, I've got the secrets of the kingdom.
Oh my God.
God help us today. I tell you in the name of Jesus, it's time for the whole church, the whole body of Christ, to get back to the Word of God. Amen. To begin to declare, stop trying to puff up and lift up self. Amen. But it's time to lift up Jesus again. It's time to fall in love with Him again. Amen. What is revival? How do we get revival? Amen. It's when we begin to love God, when we begin to look for someone instead of something. Amen. We stop, amen, looking for the gift, and we start looking to the giver. Amen. That's what revival is. Amen. Fall in love with Jesus. Church, we don't care. We know that God's going to take care of us. We know that God's going to bless us. We know that God's going to fill us up with His Spirit. The gift of His Spirit, no problem. God's going to give them. I tell you, in the name of Jesus, we're living in that day. Jesus is just about to return. And God wants to send revival back to America again. But it's not going to start on a television. It's going to start in churches just like this one. And then we're You're not at the breaking point. You're at the point of breakthrough.
Come on.
Sometimes we mistake the things that are happening to us because we're like little children at times. We so got them so afraid. And for good reason. Listen, the devil's trying to destroy your life. The devil's trying to take away your relationship with God. He's trying to destroy your home, your family. Outside of the gift of salvation, listen to me. Your family is the most precious gift that God has ever given.
Yes, it is.
We've got a little Spanish-speaking church over in Sugar Land, Texas. It's our first Spanish-speaking church. Pastor wrote something the other day, just a young man about 35 years old. He put a picture up on the internet of his family, of his children. And he said this, if I fail here, I fail everywhere. My God, it's time that we get a heart to pray for our families, but not only our families.
Yes.
And listen, not only that, but let God put victory right here. If your family, if my family sees real, real victory in our life, it's going to make them hungry for it.
Yes.
It'll make them thirsty for what we've got.
That's right.
I tell you, when the world, they might poke a little fun at you. They might maybe mock you just a little bit to your face, but behind your back, they're saying, my God, I want what he's got. I want what she's got.
That's right. Amen.
That's what's going to make the church, amen, in America again.
Hallelujah.
You talk about real revival. Let me tell you something. We can look past all the programs and we can look past all the politics that's come in our church. I tell you in the name of Jesus that God will do it. David said, I'm going to call this the place of breakthrough. I want to tell you something. There's been a lot of people throughout the Word of God in the New Testament and Old Testament. I want you to look at Lazarus. Lazarus was dead and he was in the tomb. He was past the breaking point as far as man was concerned, but Jesus was just about to break through.
Amen.
Think about that. His ordeal was over with. He was dead. He was put in the ground, but Jesus was just about to say, come forth. What is it saying to you and to me? It doesn't make any difference what the devil has said. The devil might have pronounced judgment and a final call on your life and said, you're done, you're over. You'll never be anything for God. You'll never have anything in God. You'll never know the victory. You'll never know what it means to be used of God. Amen. And it might seem like you've been put in a spiritual grave and the world has wrote you off. Amen. But God said, Jesus is just about to say, come forth in your life. God is trying to get you breakthrough. I don't care how long the promise has been waiting, how long you tarried for.
Praise the Lord.
Wait for the promise. Tarry for it.
Yes, sir.
It's going to come to pass. There are people sitting under the sound of my voice this morning, more than one. Listen, that God has called you to ministry. And for one reason or another, you've been pushed back. But I'm telling you, God has given you breakthrough this morning if you'll have it. This is a word from God. This is a word that was birthed in prayer. This is a word that's been bathed in tears straight from the throne room of God. Listen, I want you to know, like the pastor said the other night, there were times of men and women right here in this church, maybe sit on your couch and you were trying to watch television, but you couldn't because the Spirit of God was speaking a word in you. Amen. You were reading a book. Amen. You couldn't even enjoy the book because something in the book gave you a message to the world that Jesus Christ is alive and serves and saves. Amen. That he heals and he's coming again.
Come on.
You just had to tell it.
Yes, sir.
Oh, come on.
That's good, bro.
Can we talk of a time?
Come on.
Just for a little bit. Some of you are going to know what I'm talking about. When you were trying even to sleep. And you couldn't even sleep.
Come on.
Because
Come on.
Of the presence of God.
Yes.
How long has it been?
Come on.
It's been years.
How long has it been since the Lord came by, passed by your bed and said, get up, child. I'm calling you into my presence.
That's it.
I'm talking about the sweet things of Christianity.
Yes.
You know, so many people, they start talking about the do's and the don'ts. Let the Holy Ghost deal with that. Let the Word of God deal with that. But let's talk about the sweet things of God. Let's talk about the holy presence of Almighty God. That when we get in His presence, and we don't even want to leave.
Come on,
amen. The sweetness of the Spirit of the presence of God.
That's right.
Thank you.
We need victory. We're at the point of breakthrough. I tell you, God doesn't want to do it in one place. He wants to do it in every place of our life.
Yes, amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Look at verse 13 real quickly. And the Philistines yet again spread themselves in the valley. Verse 14 said, therefore David inquired again of God, and God said unto him, go not up after them, turn away from them, and come upon them over against the mulberry trees. And it shall be, I like what God said. He said it, he didn't say it might be, he said it shall be.
It shall be.
Has anybody ever heard a shall be promise from God? This is going to happen, you can count on it. Put it down in your book. It's going to happen.
It's going to happen.
Do you know why that we're not receiving those shall be promises right now? It's because we're playing out in the world too much. We're dabbling in the world too much. But when we get lost in the presence of God and we deny ourselves and we begin to pick up our cross and follow Him, I tell you in the name of Jesus, God will speak it again into our life. You shall recover. You shall minister. You shall serve. You shall be filled with the Spirit. You shall be filled with joy. You shall know, hey, that when victory is in your life.
Good
word. Bible said, verse 16. Come on, let's go down there. David did therefore as did as God commanded him, and they smote the host of the Philistines from Gibeon to Gazar. And the fame of David went out into all lands, and the Lord brought the fear of him upon all nations. Listen, if we will surrender, God is at the point of breakthrough. There, listen, every service. We felt just that pressing of the presence of God in this church. Every service, the last few services, we felt the presence of God pressing us so close, but yet not there. Can I tell you, it's time to get there. God has prepared this service so we can get there.
Amen.
Think about how you're going to respond. I said, think about how you personally are going to respond today. God has got you at the place of breakthrough, Valparaiso, victory. At Valparaiso in your life. Hear me what I'm telling you. It's at this place, this place of breakthrough, that God will do something supernatural in your life. What are you talking about? How are you getting that? What are you even talking about, Pastor? Well, David first inquired of the Lord. He said, shall I go after him? He said, yeah, go ahead. I'm going to give him to you the first time. Second time, he said, well, don't do it that way. I've got another way. I want you to go sit behind a tree and you look up and you see the going of the top of the mulberry trees. He said, then I want you to go because I've already went before you. God supernaturally defeated the enemy.
Amen.
Listen to me. Let's don't get tired of going at that place of breakthrough and still believing God for victory in our lives. This is a brand new day. How many needs a brand new day in your life? A brand new fresh start. This is a fresh start today. This is our fresh start today. And I'm telling you in the name of Jesus, listen, if we'll do things God's way and stop trying to do things our way, I don't care what worked yesterday, what is God saying in His Word to us today, and what is God saying by His Spirit to us today, I want to tell you in the name of Jesus that if we will do what God says do, when God says do it, we'll see a supernatural breakthrough in our life. I don't know about you, but that's where I'm at right now in my life. I need a supernatural.
Come on.
Yes, I need a miracle. I need God's power. I long for the day to see the power of God real again in our churches. And not just our churches, but in my life. It's one thing to sit on a pew and look all around and see the showers of blessing falling on everybody. Seem like somebody's over here getting filled with the Spirit. Somebody's being used of the Spirit. Man, good things are coming their way. And here we sit. Waiting for it to fall on me. Brother Edward, myself, and a bunch of us, we were in a great big church, thousands of people up north, in a different state. And there was this fellow there, and we all went to see him, but I never was a fan or a follower. A minister. And so, you know, I'm hard-headed, like the pastor said last night. That particular service, I said this. I said, God, I really don't believe in all this guy's doctrine. I told God, how many's ever talked to God that way? I said, God, I really don't believe in this guy's doctrine. But, God, I don't want to be a hardhead. I don't want to be a doubter. I don't want to be walking in unbelief and not walking in faith. So, Lord, if this is real, I want it. I want it. And so he did what we used to see in the football, still do in the football stands and at sports events. Something like the wave. He did like this on this side. There were thousands of people in this church. And start over on this side, and people, they were standing up and they'd fall back in their seat. Well, there was about 60 of us. Now, I don't know if they were all Church of God and Assemblies of God and Full God. I don't know what they were. But evidently, we was all the same. And man, the people just falling back in their seats and they'd laugh and chuckle a little bit. I believe in the gifts of the Spirit. I want the gifts of the Spirit being manifest in our churches today. We need it now worse than we've ever needed it.
Amen. Yes.
Just to make it plain, I'm not a Baptist. I'm not saying there are some. I know Holy Ghost filled Baptists that speak in tongues.
Amen.
So I'm not just putting it off on the Baptist denomination. I'm not doing that. But whatever you call it, listen. I'm a Pentecostal by experience, not by denomination. And so the wave came, and there was about 60 of us sitting there waiting, and we're crying, and oh God, if this is real, Lord, oh God, I want it. And man, it passed over about 60 of us, and we looked back, and it started on the other side of us, and they all start falling back, laughing a little bit. Whew. I said, God, is there something wrong with me?
Come on.
Anybody ever been there?
Yeah.
Everybody else is receiving. God, what's wrong with me? That's a pretty good question. That's an honest question.
Yes, it
is. Yeah.
I think it's a question that every man and woman and boy and girl needs to begin to ask about themselves in churches, just like with this right now, where the power of God has been flowing. Amen. And the word, the true word of God is being preached and given and taught. And people are eating on the true word of God and the real presence of God. Then I want to tell you something. We need to begin to ask ourselves, if we're not receiving God, if we're not getting breakthrough at Belperazum, what's wrong with me?
Come on.
It's time to investigate. God, is there something, Lord, that I'm not letting go of? Is there something, Lord, anything that I'm not allowing you to be Lord over of my life? You know, you have a choice in the matter.
Yes.
We have choices in the matter.
Yes.
But hear me what I'm telling you this morning, that God has brought us to a place of breakthrough right now. God is wanting to give breakthrough supernaturally in somebody's life. Jesus, this very morning, wants to change somebody's life.
Come on.
How many of you would raise your hand and say, do it, Lord?
Do it, Lord.
Yeah, do it, yes, Lord.
Do it, Lord.
Change me right now. Change.
The Holy Spirit is looking for somebody right now.
Glory.
Right now to give anointing. You see, David could have never done any of these things unless he had been anointed first. He was anointed to be king. He was anointed to take back, amen, Jerusalem. He was anointed to get victory for God. You, amen, this morning, amen, and me, we, God is looking for somebody by the power of the Holy Spirit today. He's looking for somebody to pour the power in, to pour breakthrough in, to pour victory into.
Come on.
Yes.
A supernatural change. I don't care how long that you may have wrestled with whatever it might be. Listen, it might be poverty. Come on, did you know that the spirit of poverty tries to keep down the children of God? And I'm telling you, God is concerned about everything in our life, not just the spiritual things. God is concerned about everything in our life. He even said the very hairs on our head are numbered.
That's right.
God is concerned about our feelings. How do I know? Because listen, the very first miracle that Jesus performed at the marriage of Cana in Galilee, you know what? Amen. The Bible said he turned water into wine. And that's as far as, God help us, that's as far as some people ever get in the story. They say, well, was it fermented? What makes the difference? Ask me sometime and I'll give you my opinion. The moral of that story and the real message is there. That this, in the beginnings of anything, God always he sends forth a strong message. Strong message is this. He didn't want that family to be embarrassed by not having enough food and drink for everybody that was there. And he performed a miracle because he loved them.
Amen.
You hear me what I'm saying?
Amen.
Let it sink in this morning. God will perform a miracle in your life today. I don't care how long you've been wrestling with whatever it is. God is concerned about all the spiritual things, and he's concerned about the everyday things. Amen. Listen, I want you to know that God is our provider in every way. Listen, you might be going through the biggest struggle of your life right now, and you might not know what to do, and you're just tempted right now to run out to the world for comfort like David did. Amen. But David learned his lesson. He ran back to God, and he began to pray. And I'm telling you this, we don't have to make mistakes. Amen. We can learn from other people's mistakes. We can learn from David. We can take the lessons from the Word of God today. You might be going through a rough time now. Don't run back to the land of the Philistines this morning. Amen. But pray and seek God and say, God, what will you have me do? I want you to know that God will supernaturally, he'll perform a miracle because he loves you today. God will put back the power of God, the anointing in your life, amen, to walk every day and please him every day.
Praise the Lord.
Come on, for 40 years, better than 40 years.
Praise the Lord.
God has been trying to use this church and this community.
Yes.
And he has at times. He has at times. But I tell you in the name of Jesus, we're at the point of breakthrough right now.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
I wonder if I could get the musicians to come back and play something very soft, please. Hallelujah. Would you raise your hands with me this morning? Let's seek God. Father, in the name of Jesus. God, we do stand before you this morning, Father, Lord, in need. Each and every one of us. God, this morning we need a supernatural word and a supernatural move of God. Some of you are desperate this morning. Listen, I know because I've been desperate. But it's at those times that God can really cause us to be right where He wants us to be at breakthrough. And not only at the point of breakthrough, but crossing over into it. I wonder if you're here this morning and you want to cross over into that breakthrough in your life. Get out of your seat right now and just come. Let's find God around these altars. Come on. Step out right now. God, it's me. I'm the one. I want the breakthrough, Lord, in my life. There's not any reason, listen, why every man and woman and child this morning. Listen, you've tried to serve God. Some even had a hard time understanding about even serving God. But God can give you a breakthrough in understanding this morning. A breakthrough in your relationship with God. A breakthrough, listen, in your family. A breakthrough in your finances. But most of all, a breakthrough being the men and women of God that God has called us and wants us to be. If you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you say, preacher, I don't even know what you're talking about. Can I tell you, Jesus loves you. And if you'll take that step of faith this morning, He wants to come in your life. He wants to be your Savior. He wants to be in your life every day. If that's you, I just want you to step out from where you are and come. Come now. Each man, each woman in this place, I want you just to begin to lift your hand. I want you to begin to talk to God from your heart, because that's what real prayer is. Real prayer, Rebecca Joe, real prayer, sister. Come on, we know what it is. You know what it is. It's when we speak our heart to God. The deepest longings of our heart, when we let loose, it just gushes out like a fountain into the presence of God. That's real prayer. It's just being honest with God. That's what it is. Would you pray this morning? Father, bless this church. Go ahead, brother. Go ahead, sister. Father, in the name of Jesus, minister breakthrough, Father, Lord. You see, God, physically, Lord, right now. God, breakthrough spiritually, the breakthrough, Father. God, minister breakthrough, Father, right now. Minister the breakthrough, Father, right now, in Jesus' name, Lord. God, minister breakthrough, Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, you see the backslider, Lord, the breakthrough of her body, Father, and her spirit, Father. God, to my brother, Lord, this morning, Lord, the brother and sister Johnson, this morning, God, breakthrough, Father. God, I pray for sister and my sister now, God. Oh, God, would you do it now? Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we cry out to you. God, the brother, not the Lord, to every man, woman, and child in this place, Lord, to my sister now. God, we're at the point of breakthrough. We've been there many times. God, would you help us, Father, now, in Jesus' name, sister, go ahead and believe for that breakthrough. God, I'm on the ground, Father, in victory, Lord, that's where I'm going to stay. God, I'm on the ground in victory right now, Lord, and that's where I'm going to stay. I believe it this morning, God. God, your spirit has stirred my heart. God, you excited me this morning, Lord, because of your promises and your way. God, I receive it now in Jesus' name. Oh, God, that's where I'm going to move with you now.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Church, listen to me. Breakthrough belongs to us. Victory belongs to us. We're at Valparaiso today. Oh, the enemy can't do anything to stop it. Listen, he'll try one way or another, but as long as we hold on to God, as long as we run to him, it's all going to be good. God bless you. Love you, church. Appreciate you.
Hallelujah. 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 You love the Lord today. Before we're dismissed, let's just go to the Lord in prayer. God, thank you for this word. Thank you for breakthrough. God, I receive it. Father, I pray for each and every family that is here today.